what point does undefeated quiet the critics? Nebraska coach Mike Riley arrives at Camp Randall Stadium tonight, knowing his team has heard what some have said. He cares more about what he sees. The seventh-ranked Huskers are led by senior quarterback Tommy Armstrong. They're resilient and determined. Are they college football playoff material? Tonight, they can start to prove it. Number 11 Wisconsin is battle-tested. This is already their fifth top 10 test of the season. With a defense full of fight, many sense another unbeaten is set to tumble. What do you say we finish off this big day in the Big Ten with a headliner? It's unbeaten Nebraska and the hard-hitting Badgers. From here in Madison, we welcome you to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton by Hilton. Now, later tonight, they're going to be jumping around. For now, a sea of red under the lights, famed Camp Randall Stadium. Seventh-ranked Nebraska, 7-0. Their biggest challenge of the season so far, facing 11th-ranked Wisconsin. As we say, good evening. Thrilled you're with us. Joe Tessitore, Todd Blackledge will say hello to the incomparable Javi Rowe in just a moment. You look at the Big Ten West, and many say this is a de facto division title championship game of sorts. Wisconsin has the two losses, but they're to then number two Ohio State, current number two Michigan. Nebraska's path to unbeaten's been panned, Todd.
Well, coming into today, one of nine unbeaten teams, but I don't know that anybody's been more scrutinized than this Nebraska team. Questions about the strength of their schedule. Questions about are they deserving to be the number seven ranked team in the country. But all that changes tonight here in Madison against a team in Wisconsin that's had the better of Nebraska the last few years and also is the best defense that this team has faced all season. There's no better way for Nebraska to prove a point or to make a statement than to do it on the field tonight.
That defense has only given up 8 touchdowns on the year. This Wisconsin team was unranked in the preseason. It only took a week to jump to number 10. They had that memorable win over LSU to start the year. And here they come, the Badgers. See that schedule. The tough test, and yet another one. We're knocking on the door of November. Key games like this carry even more weight. Huskers, Badgers, next. Joe Todd and Holly with you here at Wisconsin. These two played a last-second thriller last season, won by the Badgers. Let's get our first visit with Holly.
Well, these two coaches for Wisconsin and Nebraska are best friends. They have known each other for 25 years when Mike Riley of Nebraska hired Wisconsin's Paul Chryst to be his wide receiver coach in the World Football League in 1991. They are football besties. And they said, we don't want this game to be about us and our relationship tonight. But how it might be is Paul Chryst says Mike Riley is the number one influence in my football career. They go on a week-long retreat together in Texas every year where they bring game film. They talk about inventory. And here they are in pregame for 7 minutes. They're out on the field today chatting it up. So the chess match between Mike Riley, who has influenced all the calls that Paul Chryst could possibly make in this game today from a philosophy standpoint, should be very interesting. It's a good chess match. And Paul Chryst said, hey, sometimes the best fights are between brothers. These 25-year brothers are going at it tonight.
They are like family, and they could tell stories all night long about the days back in the World League of American Football, spring ball back in the early 90s. Well, Wisconsin won the toss. Nebraska will receive. The 7-0 start for Mike Riley and the Huskers. Now comes the test.
And right away, we'll get to see Tommy Armstrong, the leader of this Nebraska offense, about to make his 41st start at quarterback for the Cornhuskers.
DJ Rosowski will get us started. And it's Bryant and Nelson back to receive. So
So let's focus in a little bit on Tommy Armstrong, the all-time leader in completions, passing yards, and touchdown passes for the Huskers.
Well, he's a super athletic guy, 6'1", 220 pounds. I mentioned the experience. 41st start tonight. That's a lot of ball that he's played. He's a fierce competitor, and that's why his team believes in him. And that last one, good feet, bad feet. When he sets his feet, he throws the ball extremely well, but sometimes his feet get him in trouble. That ability to extend plays and get out of the pocket and make something happen can be good, but sometimes it gets him in trouble as well.
Terrell Newby on the ground to get the night started with a game of three. Impact players are brought to you by Chick-fil-A. We just saw Terrell Newby. He has been excellent in fourth quarters of games, closing things out recently with wins. The big news is Jordan Westerkamp is back. Their most veteran receiver missed two games. And T.J. Watt, as Collins dealing with injuries on defense, but he is so active, leading them in sacks and tackles for loss. Second and seven, Newby again, making his way to the 30. It'll be third and five from there.
This Wisconsin defense has played at such a high level all year, and they've had to deal with injuries from the very beginning. The very first defensive snap of the year against LSU, they lost Chris Orr, a starting inside linebacker. They played games without Vince Beagle. And then last week, they lost their starting inside linebacker and leading tackler, Jack Sitchy, but they just continue to plug the holes and find ways to get it done.
There is Beagle. Very talented group of backers. Third and five. Armstrong, they pick up the pressure, but it was batted down by Ryan Connolly. Outstanding play. Connolly in for Sitchy.
Connolly was coming to just attract blocking. He wasn't really blitzing. Conley's the guy who is in here replacing Sitchy. He's going to come and attract a blocker and then kind of drift back, and he had his eyes on the quarterback the entire time. Tommy Armstrong has a strong arm, but again, he's only 6'1", and that ball was easily knocked away by Connolly.
Caleb Lightborn into punt, and Corey Clement back at the 26 to return.
Boy, that was close.
And with the 4-4-5 hang time, Clement with the fair catch. So here is Alex Hornibrook, the redshirt freshman from Pennsylvania, Todd.
Well, he beat out Bart Houston, who was a fifth-year senior. He's a big guy, a left-hander. Houston, the right-handed quarterback. He's got a maturity beyond his years. I think that's one of the things the coaches really like about him. He's shown real poise under pressure. He's a guy that's going to get better the more he plays and the more he sees. And he has a very soft passing touch. The one thing I don't love when I watch him on film, throwing the deep ball, I think sometimes he guides it instead of really stepping and driving it down the field.
Corey Clement, not much there. Just about a half yard tackle by Banderas. The impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A. With the Wisconsin offense on the field, we focus in on Clement, who rushed for 164 yards 2 weeks ago against Ohio State. Jazz Peavy is the receiver you're going to want to watch, especially with the jet sweep action. And Aaron Williams has three interceptions in a much improved defensive backfield for Nebraska. Second and nine, and that is complete by Hornibrook for just 4 yards, as Austin Ramish, Jazz PB, securing that.
Both of these teams use fullbacks a lot. Ramish not only blocks as most fullbacks do, but he also catches the football and gets a chance to run it. 14 carries on the season so far as well.
Ogunbowale and flanking Hornibrook on third and five.
Fumagalli, the guy to keep an eye on, 81.
And targeting him, but incomplete.
Well, that's a really nice play by Newby. Just fighting the whole way, because this is a good throw, a good route. Fumagalli is definitely bigger, but Newby just fights through the hands. hands and just doesn't give up on the play. Has his hand right in between the arms of Fumagalli, and Fumagalli not able to pull it into his body. Nice play by Newby on third down.
Dangerous return man, DeMornay Pearson-L, but an extremely talented true freshman punter in Anthony Lottie. And Lottie gets off a beauty and drives him all the way back to the 15. Here comes DPE on the return. So Tommy Armstrong, his second chance at things against this talented Badgers defense when we return. You know, Nebraska undefeated, but not without critics. Heard the common refrain, where's the impressive win in those first seven games? And look at the level of overmatched opponents, and they didn't have a blowout, but now's the time.
Yeah.
The remaining five, this is the test time.
Well, Oregon was the best win early in the year for them, and at that time, Oregon was a ranked team, and nobody thought they were going to fall off as much as they did. That was a big win and a good win for Mike Riley in Nebraska, but now is when things really get kicked up a couple notches for Nebraska.
Inside bubble this time to Morgan, and he is met after a gain of just 2.5 yards by Musso.
Wisconsin, a very good tackling football team in space. They really make you earn everything. They don't give up too many big plays. Musso is kind of one of those guys that's just typical of this defense. An undersized guy listed at 5'10", 194 pounds, plays much bigger than that, plays with great knowledge of their defense, anticipation.
Armstrong on second and 8.
Second
that
tip
may have gotten a, yeah, right at the line of scrimmage, it looked like, on the left end. That was Chikwe Obasi.
And I think just in two plays we've seen, this Wisconsin defense is kind of keyed into the fact, hey, we're gonna get our arms up on Tommy Armstrong. If he stays in the pocket and throws, he's 6'1", and we're gonna get our arms in the passing lane, and they've gotten two knockdowns already.
Third and 8. Coming after him, able to extend the play. Capable runner, but forced out that time by TJ Edwards. A gain of just 4. They'll be punting again.
We talked about the two outside backers, Watt and Beagle. Beagle just blew up his man on his way to the quarterback, and that's what forced Armstrong to leave the pocket. Watch this bull rush by Beagle right over the right tackle. Armstrong has to leave the pocket, and this is a good decision. In the last couple years, when Tommy Frazier throws it off the scramble, that's where a lot of his interceptions have occurred. That was a good decision, even though they didn't get the third down conversion.
False start. Offense, number 41, 5-yard penalty, remains fourth down.
I can understand why Nebraska up front was a little nervous before this play. That first punt of the game, Wisconsin was very close to getting in there in a position to block it. It's kind of an unusual setup. You got a big gap in between the center and the two guards. You have a three-man shield of big bodies, but Wisconsin was very close on the first punt.
Clement from the 24 and wiggles his way free. This is an outstanding return near midfield this time.
Clement is not your typical punt returner because he's a tailback, so he's got a tailback body and strength, plus that ability to make people miss and break arm tackles in the open field. Normally you see a receiver, a defensive back as a punt returner. You don't see a starting tailback too often as the punt returner. And that's an excellent return and nice field position. Good opportunity here for Wisconsin to maybe go play action pass and get Hornibrook something easy, an easy completion here early in the game.
24-yard return from Clement. And Bradrick Shaw is now the tailback. Play action. Hornibrook Downfield he goes, and in stride to Fumagalli.
Well, Fumagalli really gets hung up in the traffic. He's right here. He's going to cross the field and go up the field, but watch, he's going to get banged around and gets kind of lost in there. And Nebraska loses him for a moment. But Hornibrook knew exactly where he was, and there's a nice completion down in close to the red zone now for the Badgers.
His 26th catch of the year to lead Wisconsin. Here's Shaw now inside the 10. Touchdown, Badgers.
Bradrick Shaw, the backup tailback, after that long punt return by Corey Clement. They give him a break, and Shaw with an excellent run. Nice job up front blocking, and an easy touchdown for Bradrick Shaw.
Took advantage of that short field after the 24-yard punt return by Corey Clement. Second rushing touchdown of the year for Bradrick Shaw. Guy who grew up in the heart of SEC country down there at Hoover High School in Birmingham. Looks fine up here in the Big Ten.
ESPN College Football is presented by Hampton by Hilton. Book at Hampton.com for a guaranteed discount. And in part by Buick, proud partner of the NCAA.
Well, the pink flamingo became a symbol of Wisconsin's unique spirit back in 1979. The tradition of Fill the Hill, the plastic pink flamingo, the official bird of the city of Madison, they named it in 09. Early touchdown lead here on Halloween weekend. Bradrick Shaw had the 21-yard touchdown run for the Badgers.
Yeah, long punt return, one long pass completion, and then Bradrick Shaw's touchdown run. I'm going to go back and show you something on a touchdown. Both these teams like to use jet sweep, so they bring a wide receiver in motion. And what you want to do is affect these linebackers and make them widen out with the fake. Both linebackers widen out. That enables Ramczyk, the left tackle, and the fullback, Ramish, to get nice blocks and an easy path to the end zone. It's timing, it's speed, and it's also that wide receiver, A.J. Taylor, in that case, showing a ball fake like he's getting the handoff. It's a beautiful way to affect eyes and move people with the fake.
Zigbo on the carry here as he only gets 2 yards there. Let's go to the studio and Chris Cotter.
All right, Joe Todd, time for Quicken Loans, bringing it home over on ABC. Texas trying to bring it home. Down 8, Shane Bouchel is going to find Andrew Beck. The fullback gets in, and then they're going to try for 2. Tyrone swoops, stopped. The 18-wheeler at the goal line. It's Baylor by 2, 6.5 to go over on ABC.
That's been an interesting one all afternoon, going for 2 there. Saw Virginia go for 2 earlier today against Louisville.
It's Tanner Farmer, the right guard, who's down at the end of the play. Both of these offensive lines have been through some injuries and moving different people around, playing different guys.
Starting right guard for Nebraska. Just a sophomore.
Corey Whitaker, number 58, will probably be the guy coming in. He's going to back up both guards tonight.
Well, to your point, both these offensive lines have had to patchwork things and juggle things around. You see Farmer on the bottom of that pile.
So often a guy gets his leg caught in the pile and pressure pushing him back, and you just hope he's okay.
So as Mike Riley looks on concerned with Tanner Farmer, we will check on him when we return. Quick break here in Madison. So Tanner Farmer carted off the field after that last play. And Corey Whitaker, we saw him come on to take that spot at right guard for Nebraska.
This is an important drive for Nebraska. Their first two possessions, six plays, two three and outs. This has been a slow starting offensive team, particularly the last 2 weeks in wins over Indiana and Purdue.
Empty look here as he fakes one way and then tries to spin free, does Armstrong. He is then sent back by Leon Jacobs, a gain of four.
Well, Tommy Armstrong wasn't expecting Sojourn Shelton to be coming on a corner blitz. There was no receiver on his side, and he blitzed the quarterback from the backside. And really, Armstrong did a pretty impressive job of gaining anything on that play and avoiding a negative yardage play.
Third down and four. Armstrong gets it complete for a first down to Brandon Riley. And with that completion for Tommy Armstrong, he now surpasses 10,000 yards of total offense. Only 11 other Big Ten players have done that.
When he sets his feet, he throws the football well, and that was good timing. He knew exactly where he wanted to go. Brandon Riley, with season high of four catches a week ago, is really starting to come on as a wide receiver.
Zigbo trying to find something on that right side, but Jacobs very active, as was TJ Watt.
Zigbo, through the first five games, was splitting time with Terrell Newby. And then he had an ankle injury, and in the last few weeks he's been used very sparingly, and Newby's carried the ball a ton. And so now, having fresh legs and having both of those guys to rotate, better chance of having two fresh backs in the fourth quarter.
As Newby looks on, and Zigbo's got him by 30 pounds, a little bit more of the power back. Second and nine. And here is a Zigbo. A stiff arm that he rides for three more yards as he picks up five.
Nice job taking advantage of the upfield rush of TJ Watt. When you got a guy who likes to get upfield and rush the passer, a draw right inside of him can be an effective play. The problem there is Zigbo got up, favoring that ankle again at the end of that play. He's being tended to on the sideline. Third down in this kind of distance, you always have to be aware of Tommy Armstrong, the runner, as well as the thrower.
Threw it behind and a little too high for Brandon Riley.
Now, I talked about in the beginning, good feet, bad feet. This was bad feet by Tommy Armstrong because he throws this football backing up. Watch as he drops with the football. There's no pressure that requires him to not be able to step into this throw. But he throws it backing up, and he doesn't make an accurate throw. And that's just a matter of mechanics and fundamentals that got him in trouble on what should have been an easy completion.
Whiteborn on to punt again. They're going to scatter from this. Takes a bounce that Clement decided to field, but they're going to rule him down, securing that at the 10 as he had pulled for the fair catch. Well, it's that interesting time of the year. We go from the poll to the college football playoff top 25 ranking. Tuesday at 7, the exclusive reveal. Reese and the guys are going to break it down. I love the fact that they never see it before. But you know how this has gone in recent years of what the AP poll thinks compared to what the playoff rankings often reveal. And look at where eventual national champions were in the initial playoff rankings.
A lot of big football games to be played. That's why The games people remember are the ones in November right now coming up. And this one tonight, pretty important as well.
Clement met right at the line of scrimmage that time by Josh Banderas.
A really nice play by Banderas. 43 tackles on the season. One of the real leaders, kind of the quarterback of this defense. Quick reaction and a great angle to the football that time. Talked about the offensive line issues for both of these teams. Wisconsin is starting David Edwards, number 79, at right tackle. This is his first start. He played 8 snaps against Ohio State, 27 snaps against Iowa last week, and now in for the injured Jacob Maxwell in his first start.
This is Jazz Peavy, and he is sent back that time. Nathan Gary read it all the way.
Nathan Gary, a 3-year starter at free safety, a 2-year co-captain, and a very sure open field tackler on that play.
Third and 7. Goomba Wally comes in flanking Alex Hornibrook. And he was looking downfield that time for Peavy. And Peavy was looking for a flag.
I think the biggest area of improvement on this Nebraska team this year has been their pass defense. Last year, they gave up so many big plays, gave up an average of 290 yards a game pass offense. This year they're down, holding teams to 218 yards. That's a huge improvement. They also have 13 interceptions on the season, which is more than they had all of last year.
So now the freshman from West Hall High down there in suburban Atlanta from his end zone. This is another good boot, driving DPE back to the 40-yard line. Able to keep his balance for a moment before eventually being taken down by Agumba Wale. 47-yard punt with a 4-yard return there. Well, this college football season, you can stream every game live on the ESPN app and watch ESPN. Download the app. Visit watchespn.com today. We were doing a lot of that earlier today, getting our fill of Michigan, Michigan State. Jabril Peppers with that spectacular return. Washington and Utah was a real interesting one as well. Things starting to shape up, and we gain clarity as the season moves onward. Armstrong with time, going to take a shot downfield. Riley denied by Derek Tindall.
A really well played by Derek Tindall. He's 5'11", going against a 6'2" receiver. This is a good route. It's a good throw. It's just a better play by Tindall. He had a bead on the ball the whole way. Maybe got away with having his left hand around the body, but made a nice play with his right hand on the football.
You know, Todd, Tindall really struggled this week with a leg injury. Didn't practice much early in midweek. Got some work towards the end of the week. Armstrong pulls it, able to get the corner, and that's where you see the explosive burst from Tommy Armstrong.
Yeah, you've got a guy out there in Shelton who's got to set the edge on that defense, but he underestimated the speed of Armstrong. The first design zone read kind of play we've seen for Armstrong, and he's able to turn the corner and bring up a third and short.
So 9-yard run from the senior quarterback. So successful in his career running the ball. And they're going to lead for him, and he was cut down. It'll depend on the spot that time.
I think they're going to give it to him.
As you saw his body fly forward, and it is a first down for Nebraska.
Got a pair of fullbacks in there. You got a fullback and a tailback leading. A lot of extra blockers. Pretty well defended by Wisconsin.
Actually benefits from rolling over the top of Newby.
Lands
here
on Newby and ends up with the first down.
The previous play is under further review. The ruling on the field is that the runner made the line to gain for a first down.
Dan Capron heads up this Big Ten crew. Bill Simons is the replay official. Of course, we have our own rules expert, Bill Lemonnier. Bill, what do you see here?
Well, you hit it on the head as he came over. Is he on bodies or is the body part touched the ground? As he makes this dive, I think he's got a right arm down on the ground. I think they're going to move the ball back, and it's not going to be a first down.
Do you see the right arm, dude? Does his arm hit the leg of Newby?
I think
watch Newby's body here, Bill. That looks like his shoulder and arm is actually rolling on the back of the leg of Terrell Newby to me.
I don't think there's enough that we've seen there to overturn the call anyway, Bill.
That'll be the decision replay has to make. Indisputable video evidence.
Nonetheless, an outstanding effort by Tommy Armstrong. I think sensing that his team offensively needs to capitalize on this field position. Down by a touchdown.
Remember, call on the field is that the spot was good for a first down. Bill, do they have the video evidence to say otherwise in your mind?
See, right there on that shot there, his elbow is to the outside of the leg. I think that elbow's down.
But can you see the elbow touching the field?
Well, if they're using the quad cams, which they are, they can take two different
review. The ruling on the field is confirmed. First down.
So it is a first down for Nebraska.
Now a perfect time. They went play action early and had a nice play by Tindall, but another good opportunity for it right here. They've had time on the sideline to get called what they want called. The guy who's back in the lineup for Nebraska that has not touched the ball yet, Jordan Westerkamp, one of their real leaders, has been out for a couple weeks with a back injury. He's right here in the slot.
Armstrong to pass on first down. Wants all of it. And that ball is intercepted by Sojourn Shelton. His second of the year.
Well, we've seen both corners make beautiful plays on the football. Tindall knocked one down, and Shelton caught one. He opens up, he has his eyes on the quarterback, he doesn't go for the pump fake, and then just makes a better play on the football than the receiver did. Alonzo Moore was the intended receiver, and Shelton just made a better play on the football than Moore did. Shelton went up with two hands, and Moore only went up with one, and Shelton got the interception.
Senior from Plantation High down there in South Florida, who's plays such a big leadership role on that defense. Clement. He was met at the line by Dedrick Young.
You know, Joe, one of the areas that Mike Riley told us last night that his team has really made an improvement in has been taking care of the football and turnovers. Coming into the game before that play, they were a plus 5 in the turnover margin. Last year, they were minus 12 for the season. And so that's a huge improvement. But that one cost them because they had good field position and were only a play or two away from being in potential field goal range.
Second and 7, Hornibrook. As he goes over the middle to Fumagalli. It'll be third and about 2 from there.
Alex Hornibrook, redshirt freshman out of Westchester, Pennsylvania. We mentioned Bart Houston, the fifth-year senior, started the first 3 games. Hornibrook became the starter after that. We'll probably see Houston at some point. He played 2 series in the game last week against Iowa and threw a touchdown pass for their first touchdown of the game.
Third and 1. Clement wrapped up. Great surge from that front. Rose Ivy was the first to get to him.
Both linebackers on the inside did a nice job. Banderas is going to come in, and Ivy, they're going to cross right at the point of attack. And Ross Ivy is the guy who gets the tackle. Banderas did his job. Ross Ivy and Aaron Williams, beautiful stand by this Nebraska defense.
Third three and out for Wisconsin, so another visit from Anthony Lottie. And DPE back to return. From the 43, makes the first man miss. And the Huskers are going to have outstanding field position on the plus side. Let's go to the studio and check in with Cotter.
All right, Joe Tess. Nebraska's in an outstanding position, as is Texas, to win this game and knock Baylor off the ranks of the unbeaten. Bouchel finds Armani Foreman here late in the going. Downfield, this puts Texas in field goal range. Clock winding down, final minute. Trent Domingue, the transfer from LSU, makes the field goal, gives Texas the lead. 2 seconds left. Baylor prepping for a Hail Mary, but Texas is on top.
So back and forth they go, deep in the heart of Texas. As Newby does what so many have struggled with, testing Wisconsin on the ground.
You know what's interesting, too? This Wisconsin defense, they battled injuries. We talked about the linebackers. The guy we have not mentioned is their starting nose tackle. That's Jack Stichy, their leading tackler, who got injured a week ago. But Olive Songopolu was their starting nose tackle. He's a 340-pound guy, and the guy that's in there now in his place, Connor Sheehy, is only a 285-pound guy, so a much smaller man, but they're holding their own.
Armstrong spins out of it on second and eight, and downfield incomplete as he was looking for Trey Foster, the backup tight end.
Another nice play by Tindall, but he didn't get any help. Tommy Armstrong didn't get much help that time from Foster. If Foster comes back towards the football, he might have a chance to cut Tindall off and make a play. He stood there and waited for the ball to get to him, and that enabled Tindall to knock it away.
Just two completions and eight attempts and 13 yards passing for Tommy Armstrong, and now facing a third and eight. Final seconds here of this first quarter. Some pressure off the edge. Armstrong complete for a first down. Westerkamp shakes loose inside the 10, inside the 5. First and goal, Nebraska.
Really nice read by Tommy Armstrong. He knew pressure was coming. He knew there was an unblocked guy coming from the outside, but he stands in there and steps into the throw, and Westerkamp turns it into a big play. Westerkamp out the last two games with a back injury, and he kind of limped off the field at the end of this play.
But they're glad to have him back. 36-yard reception will set up Nebraska with a chance to tie this game when we begin the second quarter from here in Madtown. Expedia reminds us that we're at Camp Randall Stadium here in Madison. Nebraska does not want to be reminded of their last visit here, 59-24, 2 years ago. Jordan Westerkamp being taped up. They're tending to that ankle. He has set up the Huskers here with first and goal after his 36-yard reception.
I think this is a Tommy Armstrong run situation. Wisconsin's defense in the red zone preventing touchdowns has been outstanding. Quarterback run gives you an extra blocker.
And that's exactly what they do. Armstrong tried to lower the shoulder and drive for extra yards, but he was met by TJ Edwards.
Very difficult, I think, to score in the red zone against a good defense if you don't have a quarterback run threat. Does a nice job outrunning TJ Watt. Not able to run through the tackle of TJ Edwards, but gets that ball inside the 2-yard line.
Red zone touchdown percentage. You see how stingy Wisconsin has been. Only given up 8 touchdowns on the year. Ozigbo. A big red wall of Badgers, Edwards and Watt.
Edwards really does a nice job. I mean, he's a linebacker, but he lines up as a defensive lineman right here. And he's just going to stack things up. Does a nice job getting in there, holding up his man, and not allowing it to go into the end zone. Again, I think you're better off with your quarterback getting a ball to the edge.
Third and goal. This time, Divine Ozigbo gets in. Only the fifth rushing touchdown given up by Wisconsin this season.
Really nice blocking that time. The new guard that's in, Corey Whitaker, got the key block. The guy who's in for the injured Tanner Farmer. Excellent block on that touchdown.
Giving a muddle look with the three pods for a moment there, Todd.
Thought we might see the choke play for a minute.
And somebody we know ran that earlier today, yeah, back in New England with success. They go back into PAT formation, and thus the tie game. So Westerkamp set him up, and then Ozigbo with his fifth of the year, 230-pounder, brings it in.
Nebraska evens it up on the scoreboard. Some great blocking in the touchdown run. Neville and Foster get blocked, and the backup guard that's in there for the injured Tanner Farmer gets the key block on TJ Watt. That's Corey Whitaker, number 58. The fullback was leading up in there, but he didn't even have anybody to block. Excellent execution on the right side of that Nebraska offensive line. And the Cornhuskers tie the ball game.
Yeah, Tanner Farmer was taken off on a cart earlier tonight. So a nice job of Whitaker stepping up. Drew Brown kicking off. And this will go for a touchback. Let's go to the studio and say hello to Chris again.
All right, gentlemen, we got a good one in the SEC. As you might expect, Auburn at Ole Miss. And Chad Kelly already has one touchdown pass. How about making it two? The youngster, DeMarcus Lodge, on the receiving end of this one, threads it in there perfectly. 13-10, Rebels over on the SEC network.
Auburn did last week in the game we broadcast, running the ball against Arkansas. And considering the Ole Miss run defense, they thought that would be the case again tonight. But the Rebels getting some quality play out of Chad Kelly.
Wisconsin a little stale on offense after early in the ballgame. Three and outs in their four series. 68 total yards, 51 of that coming on two plays.
Alex Hornibrook under center. Play action to get things going here. The lefty slings it downfield just beyond the reach of Austin Ramish.
Tell you what, I'm impressed with not only tonight, but watching on film this Nebraska defense. Again, last year, their pass defense, they gave up way too many big plays. They didn't have high numbers of sacks. They gave up 290 yards a game. Mark Banker, the defensive coordinator right there, this is his second year, a longtime association with Mike Riley at Oregon State. And one thing he's doing different, last year he didn't coach a position. This year he's coaching safeties, and they have another guy coaching the corners. I think it's made a difference.
Try to set up the screen, but it took a long time to get to Ramish. To your point with the defensive coordinator, Mark Banker, you know, Paul Chris and Mike Riley have the relationship, but Paul Chris and Banker were butting heads opposite each other for nine spring and fall camps against each other, offense versus defense. They know each other schematically, X's and O's wise, as well as you can.
Yeah, absolutely. Good relationship there, good familiarity with each other. And again, I think Mark Banker, just seeing the effects of second year in this system for this Nebraska defense. Much more sound in their pass defense.
Third and 11 now for Hornibrook. Trying to come back for the ball that time was Wheelwright. Incomplete. And it'll be yet another fourth down.
That's the right read. That was what we call 11 coverage, where the two safeties kind of are in the middle with a robber to try to influence you to throw the ball inside. You have to throw outside against that coverage. It was the right choice, just not a very good throw by Hornibrook.
So Anthony Lotti on to punt again. DeMornay Pearson-El, good return man.
Wouldn't be surprised if we don't see Bart Houston the next possession. They were going to play him anyway. Again, a little stale on offense right now for the Badgers.
Their catch at the 40. We'll see if they change things up as Houston maybe getting himself ready to enter stage right. Beautiful night here in Madison, Wisconsin, as we welcome you back to ESPN College Football Primetime, presented by Hampton by Hilton. For Wisconsin, their fifth top 10 opponent of the year already. Fourth time in the last five games they have faced a top level opponent. Comes in the form of unbeaten Nebraska. We were thinking Bart Houston would get his opportunity. Played last week as a redshirt freshman Hornibrook. Just 39 yards passing so far tonight. And good field position, Todd, once again for Nebraska.
Yeah. They've had the edge so far in this first half, averaging on their own 36-yard line. A good first down run play.
Let's go down to the field to Holly.
Well, Wisconsin without their top tackler, Jack Sitchy, at linebacker after a torn pectoral muscle last week that he did in the first half but came back in and played in the second half of that game. This young man is unbelievable here on the sideline. He's got a headset on. He just had surgery to reattach that pectoral muscle, but he's over here coaching up his linebackers hard. The heart and soul of this defense, he's still giving it all he has, even though he's incapacitated.
Remember, he had that big game against Ohio State, had 15 tackles on that night. Armstrong to run on second and four, and he's dragged down from behind. That was good pursuit by Dooley.
Now, Holly just gave you that report on Sitchy. I mentioned that Chris Orr was injured the very first defensive snap of the LSU game. That's him right there. So they're both, they're starting linebackers on headsets, both very engaged, very involved. Both have the opportunity to come back and play next year. And again, just what this defense under Justin Wilcox has been able to do in the absence of some key players has been pretty impressive.
Third and one. Armstrong able to get to the edge. And he was chased down by Connolly right near that line to make. This is going to be close.
That was really a good play by Shelton, the corner. We saw earlier in the game on the short side of the field, Shelton gave up the edge. And Armstrong was able to turn the corner. This time, Shelton does a nice job. You see him at the top of the screen. He's going to force Armstrong back to the inside and not allow him to turn the corner. And Connolly's able to chase him down.
And it's a first down for Nebraska. At the front of the ball, Preston Wright at midfield.
Good matchup up here, single coverage.
Newbie, nothing at all as that hole closed. Obasi able to come up with the tackle.
Justin Wilcox, defensive coordinator for Wisconsin, his first year, took over for Dave Aranda, who was very well liked, very well highly thought of. Aranda went to LSU. They thought the defense would maybe slip a little bit. Not a bit.
Armstrong, second down throw, batted and picked off, Dakota Dixon. His third interception of the season.
Well, this is a beautiful play by Alec James, number 57. We've seen this three times now. Watch Alec James. He's going to start to rush, and then he's going to drop, and he's going to have his eyes on the quarterback and times his jump. That's the third deflected pass. This time, it ends up in the hands of Dakota Dixon. This is not by accident. Wisconsin coming into the game knowing we've got a quarterback who's not as tall. We are going to affect him by getting our hands on footballs at the line of scrimmage. And the second interception thrown by Tommy Armstrong.
This Wisconsin defense is superb. And they are battered and banged up, injured, backfilling. But they are just excellent.
Tommy Armstrong obviously frustrated because guys are rushing and then dropping and getting their hands up on him.
And Clement takes the handoff from Bart Houston, a gain of 4.
There's not a whole lot he can do about that. Now, what Mike Riley and offensive coordinator Danny Lansdorf might do is start moving the pocket a little bit and getting him in some different places to throw the football.
Keep it on the ground with Clement. It'll be 3rd and 3 from there. Bart Houston was the starting quarterback for the first 3 games of the season.
It's not a whole lot of difference between he and Hornibrook other than he's right-handed. Hornibrook is left-handed. Bart Houston maybe has a little bit stronger arm. The one thing, Houston, I think, thinks he's a better runner. He kind of fashions himself as a tough guy, likes to show his toughness running the football, and this might be a situation right here where he does run it with 3rd and short.
They're 0-for-4 on 3rd downs tonight. 3rd and 2.
I think Paul Chris called timeout. Play clock was running down.
Wisconsin, they're first.
So with a new quarterback in, facing a 3rd and 2, chance to talk about it. From here in Madison, this is Dr. Pepper's championship drive game of the week. All tied up between undefeated Nebraska and Wisconsin. Taco Bell's a proud partner of the college football playoff, and you can be on the lookout for the Taco Bell student section. Student section here has had a lot to be happy about for a generation or two now. NCAA men's basketball invites for 14 years and a bowl game for 14 straight years. 3rd and 2. Houston. That was a good look that time to Fumagalli.
Now, their two guys on these 3rd down situations are Fumagalli, and he's right here coming out of the backfield. A little bunch formation, good timing by Houston, throwing it right between two defenders. Knew what he wanted, and a good throw on time by Bart Houston in a big 3rd down conversion.
Throw the kind of ball that catches itself. Just muscle it right into his hands there. First down since 9:38 left in the first quarter. Bubble screen this time, wheel right. He's picked up and put down by Chris Jones. Holly.
Well, watching the two Wisconsin quarterbacks, Hornibrook and Houston, in pregame, they are so similar physically. But one of the things I've noticed down here on the sideline that's different is the energy level. Bart Houston is a crazy man down here. His energy and his infectious attitude down here on the sideline is so fun to watch. I can see why the coaches would want him out on the field, because he just affects the people around him. There's more zip on the ball, as we saw in that 1st down throw right there.
I think Holly's right, and I think Paul Chris realized his offense was a little flat and they needed an energy charge.
2nd and 4, nothing on the inside. Michael Rose Ivy with the tackle on it.
Number 15, Rose Ivy with the tackle. Number 2 on the play.
Paul Chris, his 2nd year back home here. 51-year-old Wisconsin alumnus. Was raised here in Madison, played for Wisconsin, well traveled and successful elsewhere. But back at home.
Offensive coordinator here for several years, highly successful years of Badger football before leaving to be the head coach at Pitt.
3rd and 2, Houston. And nearly intercepted that time as he was looking for Steffes, but Nathan Gary had coverage.
It's a tough throw. Steffes, not a big receiver in this offense. Only 5 catches. And well defended by Nathan Gary.
So Andrew Endicott on to attempt the field goal. It's a 44-yarder. 5 of 7 on the year. And right down the target line he goes to break our tie here. Just feels like it's going to be a tight one tonight, doesn't it? Solid defense and measured offense. 10-7, Wisconsin. It's been an outpouring of support from opposing teams for Nebraska in the wake of their punter Sam Fultz's passing. Fresno State wore stickers. Oregon placed flowers on the 27-yard line. That was his jersey number. Northwestern with the SF Nebraska 27 stickers. The Illini had a Sam Fultz jersey made up, and Purdue a custom Fultz jersey. Of course, he was lost tragically this summer in a car accident right here in Wisconsin. So there's been a lot of emotion attached to this game this week. Osowski with the kick that Bryant is going to take out of the end zone. Todd, I just want to add to the situation in memorializing Fultz. I was with him on the day of his tragic passing, and he was committed to serving others. I watched it do it right up at the last hours of his life on that stormy summer night. Here's his dad, Gerald, in Wisconsin. He stood in front of the next generation of specialists, told his life story, reaching dreams, motivating young men, encouraging, mentoring, spoke of a great passion for football. Some years ago, I was with him in Omaha, Nebraska. I watched him spend an entire day at a training camp with a young boy who he had to patiently teach the tricks of the trade. It was my son. Yeah.
It's a great
we knew him well,
son.
And we were blessed to do so. It was a wonderful, wonderful young man. A Zigbo. And in one of the classier moves you will ever see, this was pregame where Nebraska, as they are wont to do, brings out Sam's jersey. But joining them, behind them, is Rafael Gaglianone, the place kicker, who's now injured for Wisconsin, who changed his number to 27 to honor Sam Fultz prior to this season.
That kind of stuff is bigger than the game, man.
Here's a Zigbo with a big gainer out to the 40-yard line, a 16-yard run, chunk play for the Huskers.
Boy, great job by the backup fullback, H-back Trey Foster on the cutoff block. Watch Foster right here come across the formation and get a huge block on Beagle. That's what opens that play up. Good blocking on the second level by the line, but Foster has to get that block on Beagle to give that play a chance.
Here's Newby now able to get to the edge. And the running game for the Huskers all of a sudden working against this stout Wisconsin defense.
And that's by far the best first down play that Nebraska has had. 19 yards on this run. Prior to that, they had averaged less than 2 yards a play on first down. Perimeter run. Nice job blocking on the outside by Stanley Morgan, the wide receiver. And a huge first down run for Cornhusker.
Here's Pearsonell on the jet motion for maybe 2 yards there as Derek Tindall read it well.
You mentioned how both of these teams, that's a part and parcel of what they do in their run game. They want to run inside, they want to run power and zone, but that jet sweep action, they keep you honest with it because they give it to the wide receiver enough and they try to affect the movement and the eyes of linebackers and safeties with it.
Armstrong on second and eight. And as he tried to strong arm it to Alonzo Moore, but Sojourn Shelton, who had the interception earlier, defends it. Chris Cotter in the studio.
Second quarter.
Boise 7-0 themselves. Third and eight. Newby the target that time as T.J. Watt was chasing down Armstrong. And we'll check on the flag here.
I think T.J. Watt may have been offsides. It was thrown right away.
illegal formation. 5 men in the backfield by the offense. That penalty is declined. It brings up fourth down.
Not that.
So Lightbourne on to punt. And he will try to pin Wisconsin here.
Well done.
Very well done by the coverage unit and well placed by Caleb Lightbourne.
Kyren Williams in perfect position to make that play.
NFL insiders will get your week 8 NFL Sunday going in the right direction. That's at 10 a.m. and Sunday NFL countdown takes you right up until kickoff. And then week 8 Monday Night Football on Halloween night, Vikings and the Bears at Soldier Field with an 8:15 Eastern start.
Paul Chryst electing to stay with Bart Houston. Gave him a little spark in that field goal drive. And electing to stay with the fifth year senior now with their offense backed way up close to their own end zone.
Clement going to try to give them some breathing room and he doesn't find any. That was Nathan Gary coming and filling that hole.
Gotta be smart with the football here if you're Bart Houston. If you're going to throw the football, you just have to be smart where you go with it. Fumagalli, a good choice in this area.
From his own end zone. And unable to connect to Steffes.
That's a hard catch for Steffes. He's running full speed. The backup tight end or the second tight end. He's open. This is low and hard. That's a tough catch for Steffes. A wide receiver, a little easier to go down and make that catch. A 265-pound tight end, that's a tough one.
Just 1 of 6 on third down tonight. Third and 10. And they'll keep it on the ground with Agumba Wally. And Agumba Wally gets free. It'll be a first down. Wisconsin gets them out of trouble. 14-yard run.
Nice hard run. Nice block by Ramchek, the left tackle. Watch these two guys. Fumagalli blocks inside. Ramchek leads it out. Michael Dieter, 63, out there as well. It's a big run to get that ball out away from your end zone. Even if you still end up punting on this possession, you've given yourself some space.
I'll give Agumba Wally some more work. One of the two team captains voted by a team back in fall camp.
He is also a really good receiver out of the backfield on third down. Does a nice job running routes coming out of the backfield. Sure-handed guy.
He was a walk-on defensive back 4 years ago who only played 2 seasons of high school football. But he has blossomed through his years here in Madison. Houston to the outside to Peavy on time.
Yeah, the timing is huge. Because of the timing, Peavy's able to not only catch this, but turn it upfield and add a few yards.
To think where they were just moments ago, a third and 10 at their own 3. And now out to the 31 here as we come upon 2 minutes to play in this first half. Clement the lone back. First down pass by Houston and complete again. Wheelwright this time.
Now I think Paul Chris gets a little bit more aggressive, and that's a good play on first down. He's feeling confident in his quarterback right now. Watch the protection for Houston. Steps up in the pocket a little bit. Good timing again on the outside route. Wisconsin with two timeouts, under 2 minutes, and they will get the ball to start the second half. They won the toss and deferred, so a very big possession right here for the Badgers.
Gonna pass on first down again. Pressure this time gets to him as he is ridden down by Mick Stoltenberg. First sack of the game for Nebraska.
Yeah, really good pressure. Really was Kevin Maurice, number 55, who gets there first. Watch the pressure inside by Maurice. That forces the quarterback to move, Houston. And Stoltenberg able to get the sack. But Kevin Maurice with the quick early pressure inside. Big play for Nebraska's defense.
Yeah, big Kevin Maurice, he's been their best interior guy this year.
Delay Ogunbowale
as he wiggles his way to midfield. It'll be third down and 7.
Mike Riley electing to use a timeout there to stop the
Nebraska
clock.
Their first 30
second
timeout.
This is college football, so another chance to check in with Chris.
All right, Tess, we're going to go over that busy night in the Buick Halftime Report coming up. Joey Galloway, Danny Cannell will join me. We're going to talk about a disastrous day in the Big 12 as far as playoff implications. Both their unbeatens going down. Got a big test tonight for Clemson in the ACC over on ABC in Doak Campbell Stadium against Florida State. Plenty more to get to, including Auburn, too. Talk about a resurgent team in the SEC. They're playing very well, but they've got a tough game today in Ole Miss. That's all coming up and a whole lot more on the Buick Halftime Report.
Looking forward to that. It was an outstanding afternoon. You mentioned the undefeateds. Obviously, we have one here in front of us.
Washington with a very tough game on the road in Salt Lake City today.
And there you see Western Michigan down there at 8-0. I actually spent a lot of time with P.J. Fleck this
week.
Yeah,
I saw
he was in Connecticut. He was in Bristol for a day at Sports Center and making the rounds. Talk about a high energy guy.
Yeah.
Oh, you'd love him.
Did he get it to the restaurant? Is all
he, did not. Regrettably, he didn't go for the calamari napolitan that night. Third and 7. Houston sacked again. Big Carlos Davis this time.
Wow, that is a powerful rush by Carlos Davis.
Nebraska.
John Dietzen, the left guard. He's been hurt a little bit. But this is the definition of a bull rush. Right through Dietzen. Gets him on skates, gets him backing up. Right into the quarterback. Back-to-back plays by this Nebraska defense. First by Kevin Maurice, and that time by Carlos Davis.
One of the identical twins on the defensive line. You got 96 Carlos and 94 Khalil Davis. And both good on the track and field team as well. Discus shot put out of the Davis boys. He was shot putting Bart Houston right there. Let's go to the field to Holly.
Well, they were good in the shot put, but it's pretty awkward. The only time they lost was to each other. Khalil came in second place to Carlos. Carlos, state champ.
How about that? And only Hollywood actually had that information of the track and field results between the brothers. And this time, Lottie's punt retreats to the 32. I'll remind you that you can check out our alternate angle SkyCam coverage of tonight's game. It is streaming live on Watch ESPN. It's brought to you by the Microsoft Cloud. Get a different look at things with the SkyCam coverage. Of course, you sit here with every angle known to man to break down this game, Tom.
Love SkyCam.
So 52 seconds remains, and Nebraska has one timeout. Armstrong. As coming back to the ball and getting it complete that time was Jordan Westerkamp.
Nebraska had one timeout left. Want to try to save that if they can. stopping the clock to move the chains for the first down. So Tommy Armstrong just needs to get his team to the line and get the play call. 40 under 40 seconds now in the first half.
Armstrong brought down. Flag comes down there, but it was Garrett Dooley charging in against Armstrong.
That flag in the area where you would anticipate offensive holding. Dooley uses a speed rush and beats the big right tackle, David Neville, 6'9", 315 pounder.
Holding, offense, number 66. That penalty is declined. Second down.
Utter, the center, is the guy who got called for the holding, but this is the sack on the outside. Just a good speed rush by Dooley. And now I would expect to see Nebraska just sit on the ball and eat out the clock. Or run it.
And that's exactly what they do with Newby. The two old friends, Paul Chris and Mike Riley, talked about how they know each other so well. And we kind of have a score that proves it. A tight one here. 10-7 for number 11 over number 7 as we send it back to studio for the Buick Halftime Report. It's unbeaten Nebraska and the hard-hitting Badgers. Here's Sean now inside the 10. Touchdown, Badgers. This time, Divine Azigbo gets in. Second down throw, Bannon.
Welcome back, Dr. Pepper Championship Drive Game of the Week.
And maybe it sets up as the game of the night here, as it's only a 3-point margin between number 11 and number 7. One of the 9 teams that started today as an unbeaten. We're down to 7 remaining. Wisconsin defense is awesome. Wisconsin offense, though, 4 3 and outs in their 7 possessions.
Yeah, it's an interesting first half. You know, Nebraska actually outgained Wisconsin. They had the better of the field position battle during the game, but Wisconsin played a cleaner game. Yeah. 0 penalties, 0 turnovers. 2 turnovers, 2 interceptions by Tommy Armstrong in that first half, and Wisconsin will start with the football.
And here is Ogumba Wale on the return. Moments ago, here was Holly with Mike Riley.
Well, Coach Riley, your quarterback has had a few batted balls that have led to turnovers in one case. How do you get him on the move or combat that problem?
Well, that's exactly what we're going to have to do. We'll have to get our outside game going a little bit, get some bootlegs going, and that'll give us a watch out, watch out.
Thank you for protecting me there.
That'll hopefully, if we can spread this defense out a little bit, we're having a hard time with throwing in the middle. We've hit a couple of runs, but not very many. So we're going to have a little more variety, stretch the edge a little bit.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Here's a bubble to Rob Wheelwright. And there is nothing more Mike Riley than being kind and courteous and thoughtful to look out for Holly Rowe there. We appreciate that.
Talked about the batted balls that his quarterback had. He batted one away from Holly there. That was good.
As Tommy Armstrong patiently waits to take the field. Alex Hornibrook, who started the game back out there
and
for Wisconsin.
That was a good first play, first completion for him to get a little bit of confidence back after spending most of the first half on the sideline.
And now Corey Clement, not much to have there, just a gain of 1. And Clement comes out, and as is typically the case on third down, Dare Ogumba Wale comes in. Look at how he's been limited tonight, Corey Clement.
Ogumba Wale and Fumagalle are the two guys to keep an eye on this third down play. They're the go-to receivers.
Third and 3, Hornibrook. And he looks Fumagalle's way. looks like, depending on that spot, and you can see how upset the Nebraska sideline was. They thought he was a half yard short. Mike Riley shaking his head.
Maybe he was just reaching the ball forward. He was just reaching it forward, trying to get the first down. I thought he lost control of the ball. He was actually just reaching it forward. Good catch by Fumagalli, and that reach is what got him the first down.
Now, with that 6'6" frame and that wingspan does the job in a spot like this. Play action now. Hornibrook. Lefty goes downfield. But Wheelwright was held up and never had a chance there, as there was some pressure from Carlos Davis coming in on Hornibrook.
Great pressure on the inside. Hornibrook not able to get everything onto that throw. That's the second time in the ballgame we've seen Carlos Davis with immediate pressure inside on the quarterback.
Time. Ogunbowale shifts directions and does so with great success past midfield. Finally run down by Kyron Williams, 17 yards.
Nice job by Fumagalli. Watch him get down the field and get a block on the middle linebacker. Banderas right here. Just enough to spring it to the outside. A good solid run by Ogunbowale. And Wisconsin across the 50-yard line.
Clement. First kick out was there, but then Josh Banderas was coming in hard.
Banderas really runs fast to the football. I mean, he really gets a beat on it, he reads it, and he takes a good angle right to the play. He reads it, no wasted motion, and a good solid wrap-up tackle on Corey Clement.
See the week he had last week against Purdue, 13 total tackles. Second and 9, Hornibrook. Quick toss and complete to Wheelwright, a first down for the Badgers.
Well, this is a great throw by Hornibrook because there was an unblocked linebacker coming on the blitz on the inside. Dedrick Young is going to come right into his lap, and he knows he's going to get hit right under the chin, stays in there, and delivers a strike on the outside to Wheelwright. That's the best throw Hornibrook has made tonight.
There's a bubble to the near side to Wheelwright. Not able to make much of it.
Nice blend of run and pass. Probably the most impressive drive that Wisconsin has had in the ballgame right here to start the second half. It started with that bubble screen throw on first down. A couple big throws, a couple nice runs.
See the balance with Wisconsin tonight. Ninth play of this drive, and they go to the up back, Alec Ingold. So showing a little bit of everything here on this opening drive of the second half.
Fumagalli has 4 catches on the night. 2 of them have been on third down for conversions. He's a big target with excellent hands.
He's attached on the near side here on 3rd and 7. They're going to keep it on the ground, though. Ogunbowale, how about the tough running from the senior? And at times when they need it most, move the chains again.
Well, Fumagalli with another good block. Bo Benshaw, number 66, he's going to pull out. There's Fumagalli. They clear the area. For the big run, a big hole on the right side thanks to the tight end and the pulling right guard.
Officials timeout for an injured player.
It almost seems like the Nebraska defense has been really cued in to stopping Corey Clement tonight, as Carlos Davis is being attended to. And Ogunbowale has had more room to run. He's had more green grass in front of him when he's been in there. It's been pretty smart by Paul Chris giving him the football here in this drive.
It was 3rd and 7 when he went for 15 yards there.
When you can mix it up and run on third down and not have to throw every single third down conversion, it really is an advantage for your offense.
So now a fresh first down at the 17-yard line. On that YG counter, and he slips the first would-be tackler and gets down inside the 12-yard line. A gain of 6. Let's go to the field to Holly.
Well, Nebraska's Carlos Davis has been so active up front for that defensive line, but guys, he started running to the sideline and then just dropped like a rock. They are over here examining his left shoulder. A lot of pain right now with that left arm. I'll keep you posted.
Saw what a force he could be in the first half as they continue to work on the 295-pound interior defensive lineman for Nebraska. 2nd and 4. Ogunbowale was patiently looking for an opening. Instead, he found Rose Ivy. So now a drive that's gone over 6 minutes. Coming up on its 13th play, 3rd and 2 inside the 10. Hornibrook to the goal line, touchdown, Rob Wheelwright.
Such a great fake by Hornibrook. There's only two guys going out in the route. This guy and this guy on the crossing routes. And watch the block by the right tackle, David Edwards. Made his first start. Just enough of a block for Hornibrook to have time to find Wheelwright crossing for the touchdown.
What a well-managed 13-play drive. Perfect way to open up the second half.
Excellent
test
balance
for Nebraska. Now in a 10-point hole here at Wisconsin. Wisconsin just went 3 for 3 on third downs on that last drive, a 13-play scoring drive, as Alex Hornibrook was able to find Rob Wheelwright.
Yeah. And look at the difference in his personality, just his energy. Holly reported that in the first half, that Bart Houston seemed to have a little bit more juice on the sideline. After that drive, Hornibrook looks like a different guy.
And Bryant, nowhere to go, didn't even make it out to the 15-yard line. Patrick Johnson with the tackle.
Well, he started 4 of 8 in the first half. First play of the third quarter, a little easy, safe play, and then they got their running game going. That was a huge play on third down. Another bubble screen. Good pass, run balance, and then the play action pass. The beautiful throw to Wheelwright for the touchdown. Kind of a different looking quarterback there to start the third quarter.
And there's always a fine balance as to how you manage two quarterbacks. Deal with their psyche. But well done by Paul Christ.
Worst field position for Nebraska's offense. And keep this in mind, Joe. This Nebraska offense had 3 plays right at the end of the first half, and they were out.
20 minutes sitting in the locker room at halftime. That drive, almost 7 minutes by the Wisconsin offense. They've been sitting for a long time and not playing football, but a pretty good run on first down there.
And this is not the norm for them with 7 points, as they are the third highest scoring team in the Big Ten, averaging over 34 points per game. But they haven't played this level of competition and this elite defense, no matter the injuries with Wisconsin.
Playing without their starting nose tackle, playing without their starting inside linebacker. And they just keep making plays. Very difficult to run on. Nebraska with 100 yards rushing, but averaging over 210 yards per game.
Third down roar here at Camp Randall. And a diving effort that time by Luke McNitt.
Now they're going to say complete. This is a very difficult catch because the ball's thrown behind McNitt. This kind of a route, the ball has to be thrown outside. And it's thrown behind McNitt. He tries to reach back for it and not able to secure the catch as he's going to the ground. That ball's thrown out in front of him. It's a completion for a first down. Instead, it's a punt for Nebraska.
Lightbourne on to punt. And you saw them showing a look of possibly coming after it, backing off and earning the flag.
False start. Offense. Number 52. 5 yard penalty. Fourth down.
You made the point earlier that they were awful close to getting after Lightbourne early on. And then they quickened up the tempo. His get off time got down to a 1.83. on the subsequent punt. Let's see if they come after him here. And takes a bounce out of bounds near the 42-yard line. That is Patrick O'Brien warming up. Tommy Armstrong's off to the side. Did you see what our crew did last night here at Madison? They headed over to the Madison Curling Club. You know, it's been the home to national champions and Olympians. Dates back to 1921. Grand history that was threatened last night by this bunch. Maddie celebrating. Adam, Matt, Taylor, Maddie. They won that matchup, but I think a lot of the folks on the crew enjoyed their first experience with curling here in Wisconsin.
They were taught by a former Olympian. Great instruction last night.
That was Joel Dietz teaching them up. There's Clement as he finds that first crease. Bobby, what's going on with Tommy Armstrong? We saw that shot before we went to break there.
Well, guys, he came over to the sideline and had the athletic training staff take a look at his lower back. He was complaining of pain there. They have put kind of a substance on that I'll describe as icy hot, for lack of a better term, something warm and gooey on that back. He's stretched out. He's grabbed his helmet. I do believe he'll return to this game. Both Patrick O'Brien and Riker Fife were warming up. I think probably Fife would go in next.
Yeah, Patrick O'Brien is a guy, a true freshman, who the intent is to redshirt him. He's a four-star recruit out of California. Fife is the senior, but we will see what happens when Nebraska gets the ball. For now, Corey Clement nowhere to go. And Darrison Stoltenberg with the tackle.
I think this may be the most important play to date or at this point in the game for the Nebraska defense.
How so, Todd?
Well, they're down 10. Their offense has had some problems. Tommy Armstrong is not throwing the ball particularly well, 4 of 14. They need to get a stop here, a three and out, and get the ball back to their offense and not allow Wisconsin to eat up the clock with another drive like they did to start the third quarter.
Now, this has been the down and distance of 23 and 81. Hornibrook. And he goes to Ngumba Wale, but right there waiting on it was Marcus Newby. And as you said, opportunity met by the Nebraska defense.
Excellent play by Newby. He's made a couple plays tonight. He's right here reading the play, and he's going to read the screen and
kind of in man coverage here. He's with Ogunbowale the whole way. And sometimes when you call a screen against man coverage, if you get that guy blocked, it's a big play. They weren't able to block Newby, and Nebraska forces the punt.
Now Rosowski on to punt. As he hits an umbrella wobbler to the 21, where DPE backtracks, and now DeMornay Pearsonell gets it back to the 25. So we got the report from Holly, and there he is, Tommy Armstrong, ready to go here for the Huskers. Joe Todd and Holly with you here on Dr. Pepper's Championship Drive Game of the Week. Undefeated Nebraska down 10. The Aflac trivia question earlier tonight, we told you Tommy Armstrong surpassing 10,000 career yards of total offense, the 11th player in Big Ten history to do so. So now we want to know from you, who holds the record? Who has the most yards of total offense in Big Ten history? Armstrong among the elites now, career-wise. And he could use plenty more here in this second half, as Newby takes it for three.
It's been so hard to run inside on this Wisconsin defense. Again, last year under Dave Aranda, who is now the defensive coordinator at LSU, they led the nation in scoring defense, only allowing 13.7 points per game. This year, they're fourth in the nation in scoring defense and doing an outstanding job.
So much made of Aranda leaving for LSU, but Justin Wilcox has been superb coordinating this defense. And there was some movement up front, and now the pointing game begins with Vince Beagle.
Yeah, Beagle moved first, and that caused the left tackle to move.
Offside, defense, number 47. 5-yard penalty, second down.
At the right in front of you there, number 47, when he moved into the neutral zone, that caused Nick Gates, the left tackle, to come out of his stance. Good call.
Todd, that is Wisconsin's first penalty in seven quarters. They played disciplined football. Second and two. And late there on the mesh point, but it works out for Newby, as it'll be a first down for the Huskers.
Yeah, and I think that's what Mike Riley was talking about, as you take a look at Justin Wilcox, defensive coordinator here, is the perimeter game, trying to get the ball on the perimeter because it's been so hard to run on the inside against this Badger defense.
Of course, Wilcox came up with Chris Peterson at Boise State and was part of Sark's staff at USC. Now lands here in a great spot at Wisconsin, where he has had superb production from his unit. Armstrong, as he was looking Cotton's way and coming in and getting to the ball, was TJ Watt. His older brother, the NFL superstar, JJ. JJ's overcome a couple knee surgeries, missed all of 2014. First offseason where he's really 100%, it's shown. Second and 10. Armstrong trying to weave his way through that front, but Leon Jacobs was waiting on him.
Ryan Connolly started the game at inside linebacker for Sitchie. Leon Jacobs in there giving him a break. And TJ Watt on the sideline getting looked at right now.
Sitchie out. Remember, Chris Orr's been out for the whole season. And now TJ Watt running off, seemingly for the locker room. There's Orr, headsets on with his buddy Sitchie. His teammates hoping for a stop here. Nebraska trying to stay alive. Third and 7. And a slingshot from Armstrong to Riley. Let's see where the forward progress is marked here.
They got to give it to him.
Absolutely, I mean, they do.
You know, that was Riley being smart, knowing what he needed to get for the first down. And that was one of the best throws that Tommy Armstrong's made all night.
from the left hash, plants his back foot, and delivers a shot on the curl route. Middle of the field, I should say, but this is a strong throw with good footwork and good timing, and a first down for the Cornhuskers.
Now, Riley has two catches. Both have come on third down. Now, Zigbo. And there's that pursuit down the line by Wisconsin. Holly.
A heavy dose of Ozigbo for Nebraska right now because running back Terrell Newby is on the sideline. He's on the exam table getting his right ankle taped up. He was complaining of pain on that outside bone of the right ankle. Obviously, T.J. Watt just ran to the locker room for Wisconsin. I'll give you more on that when I can.
It's a physical game. Oh. Man, these guys are knocking each other around tonight.
Ozigbo stays in as the feature back here. And second and eight. Was looking for the receiver screen. Looked like it turned into a seam from Brandon Riley. So it'll be third down for Nebraska. Holly mentioned that right ankle being tended to for Terrell Newby. As he comes in here on third and eight, Ozigbo takes a break. Big play for Armstrong and the Huskers. Closing moments of the third quarter, trailing by 10. Looks one way, comes back the other. Pearson L, and he gets loose for a Huskers first down.
Really well designed play, well executed. Mike Riley and his 14 years at Oregon State was always a big screen guy. This is a double screen. Fake it to the right, come back to the other side. It's well set up, it's well timed. And another big third down conversion for the Huskers.
Trips right on first down with Newby still in. And take it ahead for 3 yards, tackled by Connolly. Let's go to the studio to Chris Cotter.
Let's talk about this Florida State game, guys, over in Tallahassee on ABC. Dalvin Cook, after fumbling and recovering his own fumble on the previous play, barrels over from 4 yards out, 14-7 right now, Clemson on top on ABC.
Thank you, Chris.
You know, Wisconsin's fans here are going to jump around at the end of this quarter, but Nebraska has known all year they have dominated the fourth quarter. They're trying to position themselves for the end of the game.
Armstrong wanted it all with Alonzo Moore.
It's a little bit of pushing and shoving there between Shelton and Moore. Top of your screen, just a simple go route against single coverage. He didn't push him, but he grabbed the arm, and he definitely held the arm and not able to get the call.
Third and seven. 8 seconds to play in the third quarter. The House of Pain Classic jump around awaits, but can Wisconsin inflict some pain here? No, Huskers come up big. Westerkamp keeps his footing.
What a great route by Westerkamp. It looked like a wheel route where he was going deep, and then he came back to the outside for the completion.
Well, that makes things interesting, doesn't it? 80,000 will jump around in moments, but Nebraska is knocking on the door to tighten things up. A fourth quarter awaits. Glad you're with us watching the Big Ten on ESPN. Seventh ranked team in the country, unbeaten. Starts the fourth quarter down 10 here.
Well, Jordan Westerkamp is going to make a great adjustment on this route. He's going to be running a wheel route, and then I want you to see what he does when he looks back and sees his quarterback scrambling. He sees his quarterback leaving the pocket, so he breaks this run off by the first down marker, and they get their third down conversion of this drive. Beautiful adjustment by the senior receiver.
Pressure off the edge as they pull it with Armstrong, gets loose, and he's inside the five.
Perimeter runs and some timely third down passes have been huge on this possession. Big run that time by Armstrong. Again, in the red zone, quarterback run is a huge weapon for an offense.
So that'll be good for a first and goal at the three. And they bring in the bigger back, the 230-pound Ozigbo. 13th play of this much-needed drive. Well, you know how tough it can be against the Wisconsin. They're saying they got the ball. They're claiming the ball came out down there.
Ozigbo gets off the pile with the football, though.
And Joe Ferguson came in and put a hit on Devine Ozigbo. Remember, Ozigbo had the one-yard touchdown run in the first half.
And that run came off to the outside. It didn't go in between the guards. Here's the last play. Ozigbo, as he's reaching forward, body looks down before the ball comes out.
Armstrong cuts in and score it.
What an impressive drive for Nebraska's offense and quarterback Tommy Armstrong. A little bit of everything in this drive. Beautiful read. Watch the mesh point. Watch the patience by Tommy Armstrong. Put that ball in the belly, sell it, and then an easy walk in for the touchdown by Tommy Armstrong. And this sets up the fourth quarter exactly the way Nebraska wants it to be.
Dan Capron's crew talking this over here.
We talked to Mike Riley last night as we wait for the call here.
Prior to the snap, offside, defense, half the distance to the goal. You'll have the try.
Mike Riley said, you know, we haven't always been pretty this year, even though we're undefeated.
The yardage penalty is declined.
But the one thing we have done is we have really fought and played well in the fourth quarter. And they have dominated their games in the fourth quarter, and right now they've got to be feeling pretty good about where they sit, even though they're down on the scoreboard.
They came in with a national best 85-point advantage in fourth quarter scoring. Will this be a last chapter to remember here? A big fourth quarter still remains 3-point margin. Todd, I mentioned that they were the number one team in point differential in the fourth quarter, but overall in the fourth quarter, it's been so impressive.
Yeah, I mean, and you know, so you can look at that two ways. I mean, they got into the fourth quarter in tight games and games maybe they shouldn't have or people didn't think they should have, but they clearly have played their best football, most consistent football in the fourth quarter, and so has Tommy Armstrong. His QBR rating in the fourth quarter is 22 points higher than in the first three quarters of football all season.
Brown chipped under that one a little bit, so Ngombe Wally's got a chance, and he returns it past the 20. Let's go to the studio to Chris.
Clemson, Florida State. Florida State getting the ball back, down 7. DeAndre Francois is going to feel the pressure. Puts it up for his receiver. Look at this time jump here by Jadar Johnson. Beautifully picks it off. So Clemson back in business, up 7 right now, late in the first half over on ABC, Tess.
Well, speaking of Clemson, Todd, your top four as it stands right now.
Yeah, I think Alabama is still the number one team in the country. Michigan is moving up, in my opinion. I was impressed with their win today. I think their offense is getting better and better. Their quarterback's playing better. And then Washington and Clemson, still really solid. That was a hard win for Washington in Utah today.
Well earned. PB with the reception, but that was a well-earned win against a feisty Utah team. That's a tough place to play,
and it's a hard opponent to play. Very physical team Utah is, and Washington went in there and won a hard-fought game.
Alex Hornibrook, who crafted that opening drive of this second quarter, 13-play touchdown drive. push the margin to 10. Now up three here, second and one, fourth quarter action. Here's Shaw as he cuts in and has enough to move the chains. Holly?
One of the things that's been more consistent about Wisconsin tonight is up front on their offensive line. Last week against Iowa, they used six different combinations along the O-line. You know how disruptive that can be. Well, tonight they've used the same combination all game until just right now. Micah Kepwoy has come in as the left guard. First change I've seen on the offensive line tonight, so that consistency up front's been good for the Badgers.
And it's paid off for Alec Hornibrook too. He's hit his last five passes. Looks much more comfortable in the second half.
There's a play action opportunity for him, but it's picked off. That is Nathan Gary. And Nebraska will have the ball on the plus side. Gary comes up with his third pick of the year.
Now this is a play where Hornibrook just, he got locked in on Fumagalli. And he was gonna throw the football to him no matter what. Fumagalli is right here. He's gonna run a crossing route, but there's gonna be three Nebraska defenders over here. Nowhere to put the football. And Gary, the free safety, looking at the quarterback the whole way and comes up with a big interception. That's the 14th interception for this Cornhusker defense. The protection was fine. The decision of where to throw the football late in the middle like that, not good by Hornibrook.
And here is Mikhail Wilbon as he gets some work now here as Jacobs has the tackle. Well, you think that could be a sudden change play call opportunity right there. Instead, they keep it on the ground with Wilbon.
Well, they had good balance running to the perimeter and throwing in that last possession. That was a good first down defensive play by Wisconsin because they had been hurt on some perimeter runs in the last possession.
So Bart Houston warming up for Wisconsin, but for now the focus is on Tommy Armstrong and the Huskers, second and 10. And he threw it to the outside of Pearsonell.
I think he might have been bothered a little bit by Terrell Newby on that play. Newby was in pass protection and he came right in front of Tommy Armstrong. Watch Newby just cross right in front of the quarterback. I think that just distracted him a little bit and caused an errant throw on what should have been an easy completion.
Self-inflicted wound there. Now third and 10. Sojourn Shelton has had a big night.
Good pressure from Garrett Dooley. I'm not sure that Tommy Armstrong had a good sight of where he was thrown. Watch the pressure from Dooley. Got a hand up. That ball's thrown inside. And a nice stop by the Wisconsin defense. After the turnover, sudden change situation, and they force a three and out.
Lightbourne on to punt. And Peavy secures it at the 10. What a wasted opportunity for Nebraska. Still trailing by three here. Well, both these teams started the year unranked, but they have had great seasons to arrive at this point to play an evenly matched game here. Number 7 and number 11.
Both defenses playing really well enough to win. Neither offense near 250 yards yet. Paul Chris now electing to go back to Bart Houston after that last decision and interception by Alex Hornibrook.
Houston 4 of 6 tonight. Second appearance for him. This was the case last week as well. And they'll start on the ground here. And the hole was there for a moment, and then Josh Banderas came in and filled it. Reminder, your NFL Sunday gets started at 10 a.m. Eastern with Insiders, the Sunday edition, and then Sunday NFL Countdown at 11 Eastern. They would take you right up until kickoff. And then the Vikings and the Bears, the struggling Bears and the 5-1 Vikings. Jay Cutler, though, is back for Chicago. That is Monday Night Football at 8:15 Eastern. There's Agumba Wale, and he hits the hole, and he does so with a big explosive play crossing midfield, finally run down by Kalu.
Well, it's just kind of amazing that when Corey Clement is in, Nebraska's all over him. He's averaged under 2 yards per carry, but when this guy comes in, some things open up. Watch the center, Michael Dieter, get a nice block on the linebacker. And Agumba Wale is really making the most of his opportunities to run the football.
Career-long run of 39 yards. He's over 100 on the day on only 8 attempts. Did a good job using the ref as a little bit of a screen there as well. And Clement back into your point, Todd. It's uncanny.
Yeah, they're on him. Now, part of it is, I think Nebraska maybe relaxes a bit when Agumba Wale's in, thinking it's a pass formation and expecting pass, and he's finding areas to run. But he has had a lot more green space to run into than Corey Clement has had tonight.
Clement and Agumba Wale both out here as Bradrick Shaw, the redshirt freshman from Alabama, is in on 2nd and 8. Remember, he had the touchdown earlier tonight to get the night started. Play action. Houston downfield, and that ball is intercepted by Gary again.
This is a hard throw for Bart Houston. It's a bootleg to the left. Now, if your left-handed quarterback is in, that's an easier throw, but this is your right-handed quarterback. He's going to roll to his left and kind of throw back towards the middle of the field. Never an advisable throw to make. And Nathan Gary, the veteran, 3-year starter with eyes on the quarterback, comes up with his 2nd interception of the game.
What a fun night. ESPN College Football Primetime presented by Hampton by Hilton. As we continue Dr. Pepper's championship drive game of the week, and it is shaping up that way. 2nd, 4th quarter interception by Nathan Gary, and Nebraska with another chance. Newby, good job that time on first down.
You know, we showed the graphic of Nebraska in the 4th quarter. Not only have they been the best in college football at outscoring their opponents in the 4th quarter, but the turnover differential, they were right up there as one of the best, and already a 2-0 advantage in turnovers here in the 4th quarter for Mike Riley's team. It's just, you know, some things are uncanny. The way Alabama is turning it over and scoring, that's been uncanny this year. Kind of the way Nebraska has played their best in the 4th quarter, I kind of believe in that.
There's Wilbon. And he's going to be about a yard short. So it'll be 3rd and 1 for the Huskers. Leon Jacobs with the tackle. He's been very active tonight. Remember, Jack Sitchie, leading tacklers, out. So Jacobs and Connolly have been filling that role.
Nebraska 8-for-14 on 3rd down conversions tonight. Very good against this defense. And they are 3-for-3 on 3rd and 1, which is what they are facing again right now.
Under center, Armstrong just takes it ahead. Perhaps a tip-off is that Luke McNitt was the running back there flanking him, and he hasn't had a carry this year.
Yeah. Last week, in their win against Iowa on the road, they held the Hawkeyes to 2-of-13 on 3rd down. I mean, they really have been outstanding as a 3rd down defense, and that's now 9-of-15 for Nebraska, even though they still trail by 3.
He keeps, and he gets it out to the 45. What says you, Chris Cotter?
I say it's time for the Cree LED Lighting Player Spotlight, Joe Tess. And where do you see this catch by Nyquan Murray? First of all, it's a bullet by DeAndre Francois. Originally ruled incomplete, they reviewed it. Touchdown by Murray. So here come the Noles, down just three late in the first half on ABC.
That's what I like is symmetry in our primetime cruise. 17-14 across the board here. Second and six. Armstrong gets it out quickly to Morgan, who has the first down. Dangerous in reaching out, but he is down. And a first down for the Huskers.
Tommy Armstrong lost his footing as he made that throw. Still made an accurate throw, but he fell down right as he released the football. Watch Armstrong as he goes to step in this throw, just kind of takes a funky step. Still delivers a perfect throw for the first down.
His left foot just gave out. Zigbo on first down met at the line of scrimmage that time by Edwards. Your Aflac trivia answer, we said, who holds the record for most yards of total Aflac offense in Big Ten? Familiar name. Drew Brees, back in the late 90s at Purdue, 12,692. Tommy Armstrong, over 10,000 yards of total offense now. Only 11 in Big Ten history have done that. Second and 10, slings it, gets it, Morgan, stiff arm, extra something juice, Nebraska.
Boy, another beautiful throw by Armstrong. Again, good feet, bad feet. When he sets his feet and throws on time, he can really throw the football. Perfect throw, perfect timing, and then the stiff arm and strength and extra yards for Stanley Morgan.
Fagaro couldn't come up with the tackle. And Stanley Morgan goes for 25 yards. Here come the Huskers. Newby hasn't been there all night. Big Connor Sheehy.
Connor Sheehy started the first several games as a defensive end, has had to move inside to play that nose position. He's just a good, solid, blue-collar, tough football player. Holds the point and makes a nice play for a short yard pickup on that first down play.
This is what Nebraska has been all year, a fourth-quarter team. Can they stay that way against one of the nation's best defenses? End around Westerkamp. Tremendous effort by Ryan Connolly to track him down, a loss of one.
Boy, Connolly shows some speed because Westerkamp, I think he thought for sure he was going to turn the corner. Watch Connolly right here. Read it. And then the speed and acceleration to get to Westerkamp before he can turn the corner. And another third down. That was a loss of yardage play on second down.
The wall of sound from Camp Randall, third and 11. The decision to run it up the middle inside the 20.
Yeah, well, it's a three-point game. I mean, you run that play, Joe, thinking two things. Number one, if they're really geared in to stop the pass, we might sneak one in there for a first down. If not,
let's take the field goal.
That's right.
Drew Brown, 42 career field goals. He's got a great leg, and he's had an awesome career. 35-yarder to tie it. How about it, folks? 17-17. When they were asked the tough question, Nebraska came up with the answer. We're all tied up. Well, the top 10 rankings are brought to you by good year. Michigan was impressive today. That was a great battle between Washington and Utah. And you look at numbers 6 through 10, and that's where you find this Nebraska team that's been so heavily criticized, yeah. Todd.
Well, and we asked the question before the game. This was their time to really prove a point. I mean, are they a legitimate top 7 team? And I think they've shown themselves very well tonight.
Agumba Wally will take a knee. Todd, how does Wisconsin approach things now? 3:43 to play. Both quarterbacks have thrown fourth quarter interceptions.
And both interceptions were bad interceptions.
Yeah, they were.
Bad decisions of where to throw the ball, when to throw the ball. I think they'll go with Houston. I think if you look over the course of the whole game, I think the older guy has given them a little bit more spark. And I think that he looks like he's the more confident of the two guys right now. But that's a tough decision for Paul Chryst.
And Nebraska with momentum here. Remember, they trailed by 10 to start this fourth quarter. Nathan Gary with 2 fourth quarter interceptions. And there is Bart Houston in at quarterback. And he will give to Clement. And Clement finds a nice seam, gets free into Huskers territory. Just what they needed.
Last week, it was a 3rd-and-1, 34-yard run with 4 minutes left in the game by Corey Clement. That was the huge play in the game. This was his best run of the night. Excellent stiff arm, and he finally had a little green grass in front of him. Nice block leading the way for him. Eric Steffes. And the first time tonight that Corey Clement has seen that much green grass in front of him with the ball in his hands.
41-yard run to start this drive as we come upon 3 minutes to play. This time they're able to get to him. Let's go to the studio to Chryst.
All right, guys, we already saw Navy go down. Another group of five team with a hopeful play in the New Year's Six Bowl in trouble tonight. Boise State at Wyoming. Look at the Cowboys, Josh Allen, rolling out, directing traffic, and finding Tanner Gentry in the back of the end zone. They went for two and got it, all tied late in this one, guys.
This is one of those movement days of college football. A lot impacting what we have known, and how will this play out? 2.5 minutes to play. Agumba Wale made a decision to turn it upfield and got himself to the 28. A 6-yard run from Dare Ugumbawale, who's had a sensational night over 100 yards, as Andrew Endicott patiently waits to see if he gets his chance. Third and 4. Keep it on the ground. Agumba Wale. And he is met right at the line of scrimmage by Josh Banderas.
That was a big time play by Banderas. Fought off the block.
Timeout. Nebraska, their first 30-second timeout.
Remember, Endicott made from 44 earlier tonight. All on the 26. So it'll be in that same range there.
That timeout there by Mike Riley, just so everybody knows, that wasn't to ice the kicker or anything like that. That was to conserve as much time for his offense, because there's a minute 48 left in this ball game. So he's already thinking, if they make this, we want to have as much time for our offense to try to get back down the field and score as well.
Keep in mind what happened last year with that guy, Rafael Gaglione, who had back surgery and is now out of action. 39-yard attempt with a minute 26 to go was off the upright for Wisconsin. But with 4 seconds to go, a 46-yarder would go in, and Wisconsin would get the 23-21 win. Now this from 45 for Endicott to take the lead. No good. Nebraska, with two timeouts remaining, will take possession with a minute 43 remaining in regulation.
This one never had a chance. It, no, it was outside from the very beginning. It was pretty well struck, but it was left the whole way.
It's also very bad rotation, not end over end, and unable to control your target line that way. As Paul Christ,
Tommy Armstrong, hope. Only 9 of 24 in the ballgame. No touchdown passes, two interceptions, but he has been a much better quarterback in the second half of this game.
Armstrong on first down. Good completion for 9 yards to Stanley Morgan. Figueroa was right on top of it, but the Huskers start off with a good completion here. Two timeouts remain. Clock counting down. Under a minute and a half.
And playing for a field goal is different than playing for a touchdown.
Another completion to Morgan as he spins free just short of midfield.
Perfect timing. Back shoulder throw. Can't do it any better than that. Defender has no chance with that kind of timing and placement of the football.
Drew Brown has a career long from 51. First down, Armstrong with time threw it low to the outside as he was looking for Sam Cotton. Will Brown get his chance? House money now, all tied up here with 59 seconds to play.
You know, I wouldn't be surprised if they come back to that same look. Westerkamp was breaking free on that play and was wide open.
We'll swing it to Newby. Well tracked that time by Shelton.
That guy's had a nice ball game tonight.
He's been exceptional. Had the interception earlier. He's been a good force tackling from that corner spot. Third and 10.
Be smart here if you're Tommy Armstrong. You don't have to force a play.
Pumps, launches downfield. And unable to run under it was Brandon Riley. But by managing the clock the way they did, a fourth and 10 with only 16 seconds remaining on the game clock.
Nothing wrong with that. You take a shot at it. Now you just have to protect your punter and get ready to play overtime.
Lightbourne back to punt. You felt they could have come after him early and it was close. Since then, he's been able to get it off. Peavy back to return. And it takes a bounce into the end zone as the clock only has 8 seconds remaining in regulation. And a few weeks ago, Wisconsin danced in overtime with then number 2 Ohio State. Nebraska has had exceptional fourth quarters, but closing teams out to earn a 7-0 mark. Reminder, Nicole and John will have Sports Center at night. Get you up to speed on game 4 of the World Series, a ridiculously entertaining day of college football and all the NFL news. But for now, we've got great drama remaining here in Madtown, as Wisconsin will be content to see overtime.
As we get ready to go to overtime, my first impression, even though Wisconsin is the home team and that's an edge, Nebraska, I think, has the edge in overtime because of the running ability and the threat of the quarterback run of Tommy Armstrong.
Two old friends. They say your best fights are with brothers, Riley and Christ. They're going to go past the distance. OT awaits. Good Hands Play is brought to you by Allstate.
Nebraska's defense coming into the ballgame, 13 interceptions. In the fourth quarter, Nate Gary with two huge pickoffs, one off of each of Wisconsin's two quarterbacks, to put his team in a position to try to win this game in overtime now. Last year, in 13 games, this Nebraska defense only had 10 interceptions. They now have 15 in their eighth ball game.
Shake hands, captains. Congratulations to both teams on a well-played football game. We're going to have another coin toss right now. Just as at the start of the game, we're using the ceremonial coin. Mike Sadler on one side, Sam Foltz on the other side. Nebraska, it's your call. Foltz's call. It is Foltz. You've won the toss. You want to go on defense first? Okay. You get to decide which end of the field that we play on.
We'll play on the student section side.
Play down there.
Yep.
Put your backs to this goal. Nebraska, put your backs to that goal. It will be first and 10 for Wisconsin. Shake hands, gentlemen. Good luck.
And how about Gerald Foltz, the father of the late Sam Foltz, watching this game and hearing that in front of this crowd of over 80,000. Foltz on one side, Sadler on the other. The two Big Ten great specialists who lost their lives this summer. And there's Sam's mom, Jill, as his jersey remains. Both teams honoring a great legacy and memorializing Sam Foltz here tonight.
You know, Joe, as we get ready to watch Wisconsin on offense first, one thing we haven't said that's worth noting, Austin Ramish, their starting fullback, got hurt earlier in the game. He has not been back. And so they are going to play this overtime period without their lead blocking fullback.
So Wisconsin will start things off. Clement, well blocked as he gets his way towards the 20 for 5 yards. Kalu with the tackle.
Nice tackle by Kalu, because I thought Clement was going to break that for a longer game.
Number 5 on the play, 2nd and 5 from the 20-yard line.
Again, Fumagalli is the guy that you got to pay attention to. They try to hide him over here in a bunch set.
They'll keep it on the ground with Clement as he bounces it to the outside and will have a first down for Wisconsin.
Really nice run by Clement. Fumagalli gets a little bit of a block, but this is just a good bounce read by Clement. Instead of hitting it up there, he sees that white defense collapse, and he bounces it outside for the first down. It's been a workmanlike night for Corey Clement. Back-to-back 100-yard games. He's 30 yards shy of that tonight, but that was a huge run.
This time ahead for 2 yards as Kalu was able to get to him.
This is where it gets really difficult to score touchdowns in this part of the field, because the field shrinks, your pass coverage doesn't have to defend as much field, and if your quarterback is not a running threat or you don't have that part of your offense, it really relies on timing and repetition on your pass game in this part of the field. Now, with Bart Houston in the game, he is more of a running threat than Alex Hornibrook.
Guy next to him is not too bad either. And he gives it to Agumba Wally, who cuts in to the outside and scores it. Huge night for Dare Agumba Wally.
A really nice job by the left tackle Ryan Ramczyk and the center Michael Dieter getting out in front of that play
to get the touchdown.
Oh. Endicott missed the extra point. So now an open door for Nebraska. Endicott, remember, he missed the field goal at the end of regulation. Let's watch his head here. Does he come out of it early? And kept his head down, just came across the ball and struggled as he did the last time. So now Armstrong sits back and says, let's get ourselves seven.
Well, they did score the touchdown, so the pressure's still on. Watch these two blocks. The tackle and the center get out in front of Ogunbowale on this play. Ramchek, the left tackle, with a block. Watch Dieter right there. And Ogunbowale slips right in between those blocks and gets it to the front pylon for the touchdown.
So now, instead of matching, Nebraska's thinking winning. Six and a PAT, and they stay unbeaten.
But getting that six is easier said than done against this Wisconsin defense.
This defense has been sensational all year long. As Endicott just has to hope that they do it one more time. The missed extra point as Gaglianone, who was the starter and now out injured, tries to lend some support. Second and seven. Taken down by Connolly. We have called his name time and time again.
Boy, just perfect timing and anticipation by Connolly. He read the play so quickly. Here he is right here. His eyes are in the backfield. As soon as he reads this, he hits the gap and gets to Newby before he gets to the line of scrimmage.
Sitchie's out for the year. He looks on. Third and eight. Armstrong pumps, throws, nearly picked off by Dixon. It will come down to a fourth down.
Well, he was looking for Westerkamp, and Westerkamp got knocked down. I'm not sure how that doesn't get called. Westerkamp got collided with as the ball was in the air by T.J. Watt. Watch Westerkamp get knocked down by T.J. Watt as the ball's in the air. I'm not sure how that doesn't get called.
Fourth and eight. Camp Randall lets it roar.
Dakota Dixon to come over and make a play. If it's to the outside shoulder, I don't know if the safety can make that play. Inside, Dixon, a huge play for the Badgers.
Another undefeated has lost today. Nebraska comes to Madison in a thriller in overtime. Wisconsin takes it 23-17. For Holly Rowe and Todd Blackledge, I'm Joe Tessitore, asking you to enjoy the rest of your night, including SportsCenter at night, right now.
Ah, the college kicking game. Who needs it when you got a defense? And down goes Nebraska. Howdy, my friends. Welcome to SportsCenter. I'm Nicole. That over there, John Anderson, don't get any closer than this line.
Very good. Oh, safe space.
Yes.
Go Big Red. In this case, it's the boys from Madison that win it. We go out to Camp Randall on the banks of Lake Mendota. Here's Holly Rowe with their winning coach.
Well, we're here with Coach Paul Crist and Ryan Conley, the linebacker who had an incredible night tonight. And Coach Crist, in overtime, your kicker had been shaky, but you relied on your senior quarterback. How did you make that call what to do late in this game?
I just kind of, we knew we were going to play them both, and all the guys competed and played hard and just kept persevering and proud of them.
At the beginning of this week, you said to your team, we are going to need everybody to continue to win this season. How much did that mean to you that everybody did contribute tonight?
Well, obviously proud of what they all did, not just tonight, but to get ready for this and all the work they've done leading up to it. And there's no doubt, and great examples. You know, Ryan does a great job. But there's so many guys that for us to be the best team we can be, we need everyone, and these are just examples of it.
Bringing in Ryan Conley, the linebacker. You know, when Jack Sitchie, the heart and soul of your defense, goes down, is out for the year, and you step into his place tonight, how were you able to shoulder this load?
I mean, just my teammates having confidence in me, and, you know, Coach Wilcox putting us in great positions all night. You know, just you got to go out there and do your job, and that's what we were able to do.
When you saw that the missed PAT happened, how stressed out were you for that last possession in overtime?
No, I mean, that's what our defense loves to, you know, situations our defense loves to be in. And so, you know, we were hyped up to go out there and win that game for our team. So that was awesome.
On third down, you come in and make a huge play. How were you able to step up in that moment, Ryan?
I just knew it was, you got, if you're going to take it, you got to make it. That's what my coach always said. So I saw an open gap and I just shot it.
How does this win over an undefeated Nebraska keep your hopes alive for all your goals for a Big Ten championship and even more?
Yeah, all the goals we set out before the season are still there. So, I mean, that's just another stepping stone in the season, and, you know, we're ready to go. Keep it going.
Thank you very much. Yeah, Joe, they needed everybody, and boy, did they get it tonight.
They did. It was sensational, Holly, and this is a trophy game. The Freedom Trophy is what they play for. Bronze Stadium with the flag coming out of the wooden frame here. That was a fun one, Todd.
It sure
was. You
know,
Paul Crist made a great point. He said, hey, we needed everybody. It's had to be a team effort. You play a couple quarterbacks, you put in your star running back, and yet it's your backup running back. Third down special goes over 100 yards. Yeah. And then you lean on the defense.
The defense has been there all year, and even though they've had to mix and match and put some different guys in, Ryan Conley comes in for Sitchie. He has a beautiful game. I don't know what his total tackles were, but it was probably double digits, close to it. And as you mentioned, Ogun Bowale was outstanding. 11 carries, 120 yards, had the big touchdown run in overtime. It was a little tough running for Corey Clement, but Ogun Bowale was outstanding.
Holly's down on the field with him right now.
Well, on a night that yards were hard to come by for Corey Clement, you came in and were able to find some green grass. What was different for you out there running the football?
I was just making sure I stayed patient, and Corey did the same thing and ended up opening for him, and I was able to get some holes early on, too.
Right before the overtime period, I saw your ankle get injured. You're trying to shake it off over on the sideline, and then you come up with a huge touchdown run. How did you do that?
I think it was more of a scare. You know, I kind of heard some things I didn't want to hear coming out of my ankle, and I was kind of more worried than anything. But I found out I was all right, and then Coach trusted me and gave me the ball and let me get the touchdown.
What was this like for you guys tonight? You're going with two different quarterbacks. Coach stays with Houston, the senior, late in the fourth and in overtime. How does that affect the team?
I wouldn't say it affects it at all. You know, I mean, guys shuffling in and out of the huddle in practice. So we came to the game, and it was just the same, you know. So it wasn't anything that we weren't ready for, and we came out executed regardless who was under center.
Thank you very much.
No problem. Thank you.
So Nebraska came in 7-0 on a day when 9 entered the day unbeaten. You see Nebraska, Baylor lost to Texas, Todd. West Virginia lost to Oklahoma State. So the Big 12 situation is taken care of for all intents and purposes. And Boise, a good solid Boise team, loses to Wyoming. There were a lot of critics of Nebraska saying they haven't played anybody to get to this point. They would be exposed tonight. What was your takeaway of Nebraska?
I thought they played pretty well.
I did too.
I thought their defense played really well. You know, they gave up the touchdown in overtime, but before that had done really well. I thought Tommy Armstrong struggled in the first half. They had a couple turnovers. I thought he played better in the second half. But again, it was the Wisconsin defense that was the story of the game. Nebraska coming into the game had averaged 34 points a game, almost 450 yards of offense. They were held to 17 points in overtime. And just a little bit over 300 yards of total offense. So that Wisconsin defense, Justin Wilcox, the coordinator, you know, calling the shots, moving people around, guys stepping up, playing for injured guys. I just thought it was a marvelous effort by that defense.
You know, based on the version of Ohio State I saw last week and I saw today against Northwestern, I'm looking forward to seeing this game next week. Nebraska at Ohio State. But here in Madison, the Huskers suffer their first loss. Let's go back to SportsCenter.